Dragon for that play. They still got rid of the shot caller for a little bit. You know, when you're dead in your shot calling, it's actually a lot more difficult too.
Sure.
Because you're sitting there like, you aren't really like an omnipotent god being like, okay, now you guys go here, you guys go there. It's kind of like, oh, I'm dead. And then you let people who are alive kind of communicate what abilities they have left. Mm-hmm. You can like give a general sense of what's going on, but you can't really have any influence on it, like pillaring.
Yeah.
Like doing things here.
So. Sure. That's going to be an important thing to look at then is how these guys play. Once they pick up new rosters there, Jax banned away from Chris Kasten and away from Baby Zeus, and Lulu will be the first pick for Frank's Fan Gaming. Yasuo still up.
Yeah, you kind of force Curse Academy to pick Yasuo here or have to deal with a Lulu-Yasuo composition.
Ooh,
yeah. Baby Zeus will play Lulu, and Niantatsuo will go ahead and he'll play Yasuo top and see what they do with that. So Curse Academy, it's good. They're going to have to do some thinking here because ManCloud, he's very good at Yasuo.
Sure.
Two games he's played Yasuo, they ended up winning and he crushed both of them. I think they would go with the Yasuo here pretty easily.
I think it makes the most sense, but we'll see. I like the Elise Scribe as well for St. Vicious, one of Captain Ziploc's best champions. St. had a great game on it. I don't see why you wouldn't go for that one here, but instead, because Kata maybe has a different plan. So you know what? Let's just shut down your bot lane even harder. We got Lucian in the first game. We're going to ban it away, remove even more champs from you, also take away the Corki from Latman. Now what do you have?
He's left with pretty much a tier down, because you got Corki, you got Twitch, you got Lucian out of the picture. He's left with things like Jinx, which would synergize with a Wombo combo team composition, which it looks like they're making right now.
Wow, Frank McGaming Gaming telling on that pretty hard. I would almost look to maybe secure support here, but they're choosing to go for this one. Maybe we're going to take some time on this one, because Captain Zilla can play a lot, and we got 30 seconds to go. I think Yasuo makes the most sense here. Honestly, I think they should go for it again. You point that one out. The fact that ManCloud didn't grab it means it's not really a rush pick anymore, but I think it's just so good in general for FFG. They just should pick this up. I think it's the right kind of comp to go for, stuff they're comfortable with, and they clearly need to do something different compared to game one.
Yeah, it looks like they might go for the support here and just pick up the Thresh and go for the assistance on the Yasuo as well.
Yeah.
So far, everybody they've picked can assist Yasuo in some way, shape, or form for the last breath. Granted, the Thresh is not completely locked in yet, but they do want to take that away from Bunny Fufu too.
Oh, sure. Yeah, Bunny's a freaking great Thresh player, so that's going to get removed away. So now Draven and Quinn are going to be the last two pickups to have some more knockups.
Tristana, too.
Yeah, I forgot about Trist.
One of the original 40, man. You got.
I know. I actually love Tristana. I just forget about Buster Shot. Like, I forget about knockbacks counting. I don't know why I forget that. But
yeah, it says knockup, but pretty much any displacement, including Trundle Pillar and things like
that. If you force an enemy champion to move, it does it. Dude,
if it's an inch.
Do you remember that the Trundle Yasuo game?
Yes, that was absolutely incredible.
That was ludicrous. That was great, though. That was a whole bunch of fun to watch that one. But yeah, you had instant knockups from Trundle Pillar. Curse Academy now to make their choices. These guys have actually split their picks back and forth. The top and mid laner are known from FFG, as is their support. And Curse Academy say, okay, well, we can pick our soul lanes now really safely. They could also try to hide the direction of their team comp if they try to save those a bit longer.
There's a lot of things here for ManCloud and for Chris. I mean, they could go for Kayle right now. It's still left up. Or he could go with a Twisted Fate. You know, LeBlanc is still available too. But it looks like that's going to be what he goes for. They have a lot of lockup on this team, though. A lot.
Interesting. I'm surprised at TF when you know you're facing a team fight sort of comp. Now, TF's wave clear is pretty good. So you can hold up against a team that's kind of weak at sieging. You know, a Yasuo team, not the best siegers. You're relying on your AD carry at that point. So that's understandable on that front. But it's not like it's the kind of team where you're like, man, we sure need to get on that Nidalee. Sure got to get in on that Twitch, right? It's like,
yeah, you want the engage.
You'll Lantern whoever he jumps onto. And like I'm surprised at TF. I want to see how it plans out because there's a lot of ways he could fail.
Yeah, there's definitely a lot of ways that he could misplay that. But in the laning phase, you know, he can zone out Yasuo a tiny bit. Thing is you're very immobile versus him. If he can go ahead and windwall your gold card
and he
engages on you
and
he just sticks to you, and then he can trade and get out very quickly. He doesn't have to just run away from you. He can just E back to minions and get out.
Yeah.
So, I don't know what I'm smoking because it's going to be Lulu mid.
Yeah.
I was like, what?
At some point, they'll fight
each other. I was like, what? What's going on? Yeah, I was talking about lane mechanics there because Baby Zeus is going to be playing Lulu. I just saw Niantatsuo and Lulu, and I was like, yeah, he plays that too. I mean,
it's on his name.
It could happen. Ian
to be fair, like, this could be a legitimate team.
Yeah, that's true. But it most likely is going to be a Lulu, who does pretty decently. You don't lose lane against Twisted Fate. He doesn't really destroy you for the most part. Lulu, they both.
I don't think she loses like almost any lanes.
Yeah, she doesn't. She pretty much goes even everywhere.
Yeah.
Even against Nidalee and things like that.
Yeah. I mean, I'm sure there's like some challenger midlaners out there who are like, oh, here's the Lulu counter. I'm like, okay, fair.
Yeah.
Like,
she doesn't lose anybody.
She's
top.
First picked a bunch for a reason.
Yeah.
Right? It's because she's really good at pretty much every matchup.
Pretty much Kayle is the one it's like, oh, maybe you'll beat me.
Yeah.
But we'll see.
Yeah. I mean, there's ways to go around it. But Vi is going to be the last lock in there for Frank Fang Gaming. Again, in the face of Morgana. Don't seem to care very much in this one. Captain Ziplock will go back to that one. He's got two knockups himself, so plenty of displacement to set up Yasuo. See how that pans out. Bunny Fufu going to make the last pick for his team, and Chris will be playing a Shyvana one more time. It's been locked in, so it's going to be Niantanzo against Shyvana.
And you actually do really well as Yasuo versus Shyvana around level 3-ish, and you just scale better than her in terms of just flat-out damage. Thank you for Frank Fang Gaming, though. They don't have a dedicated tank. Lulu can turn somebody into a tank for a little bit, but Captain Ziplock, last time we saw him get the Sight Stone, which delayed his tankiness because then he went Lizard, and he really didn't get a tank item. His health bar, he was sitting at about a little bit over 1,500 or something along those lines last game.
Yeah.
Wasn't really tanky for his team. Didn't get to that point, but they were shut down. Whereas Curse Academy has a very tanky front line here. They have a black shield to stop at least one person from getting knocked up. There's a lot here for Curse Academy that's very similar to their last team composition. The only change is ManCloud not playing Yasuo.
Pretty much. Yeah, I mean, Corki, to be fair, can fill a lot of the same roles as Lucian. So.
Yeah, that's true.
Curse Academy basically running the same kind of stuff. ManCloud is moving his stuff around. Again, still want to see how that TF does pan out in this game. But this, to me, is a good sign for Frank Fang Gaming. They were put down very hard early game in the first game. Their bot lane especially was difficult, but now they're running with Thresh Caitlyn. It's really hard to lose a Thresh Caitlyn, so I think their lane should be much safer. They have good disengage tools. And again, they're playing a comp that like fits what this team wants to do. Nien is a great player. He's a shot caller, and it's built around ways to let Nien carry the game.
Yeah, they all have something that allows the shot caller to get off his ultimate, the last breath, and get something out of it, except for Caitlyn, of course. But here's the thing, is they've run this comp multiple times. I'm looking at the history, and in their first game, Niantanzo played Yasuo, Baby Zeus played Lulu. Then 2 games later, same composition came out for them. Granted, they did lose that game 2 games later, but they had really good score lines.
Okay.
You see, Yasuo, Niantanzo went 7-7-11. Baby Zeus went 5-2-11.
Yeah.
So they had really good scores despite losing that game because they know how to run this composition in team fights, not so much in closing out the game against a team composition that's going to wave clear on top of you.
Was that the...
That was the Law Pro.
That was the Law Pro game?
That was the Law Pro game.
The hour-long Law Pro game.
Yes. I think it was an hour and 6 minute long game.
Something like that.
Something really close to that where they just got fed up and said, base race, go.
And they misplayed that one a little bit. But we'll see how they can handle this one. Frank Fang Gaming looking to close the game out before an hour long.
Yep. St. Vicious. Forgot his trinket.
That's true.
He should have got a scrying orb. It'd definitely help them right now.
I'm surprised you can't see those like bright neon lights in the sky.
Nope. I don't know what Saint's doing up
really
there.
Really tall.
You don't have a ward to place.
I think he realized this point. He's like, guys, I can't. You can set a spiderling.
I can't ward. I have to. Oh, what? What?
The massive phase check
just
is coming.
Right there, it's coming.
There we go. We damage the hook on a Saint. He's going nowhere. Kill picked up. First blood on a Saint. Now the rest of these guys got to be careful. Baby Eater's got no hook. So they back out with a free kill. Saint, just spiderling that. I'm really surprised by that. Like, to be fair, I'm really surprised by that.
Yeah, no ward to place. Didn't throw out a spiderling for it. Ends up risking his life and losing his life for it. And once again, talked about it over and over again. Curse Academy from behind. Their calls are borderline abysmal.
Saint didn't buy a trinket again.
Yeah.
So he actually came to level 1, realized he couldn't ward anything. Died, still didn't buy a trinket.
The pressure is on. The pressure's really on. They're even ahead. They're up a game.
I'm just so surprised. Yeah. I'm very surprised. And it's gonna be one assist, by the way, going to everybody, which means not much for the early game items, but it will mean your assist streaks start sooner. That first blood might actually be worth a fair amount of damage. Mm-hmm. Or a fair amount of gold if you start getting a couple of team fights in. Just because of the way those mechanics work. Chris and Saint are gonna share XP level 2 there on the jungler. Yeah.
I think the biggest thing about that first blood is everybody in lanes is going to hit level 2 first. And you'll get that pressure. But the thing is, they lane swapped it.
This is interesting to me, actually. So Saint got a buff on the weak side of the map. Like, his dual lane is top lane, and yet he got to get a buff on the side of Latman and Baby Eater. Looks like we're not going to see Saint, Bunny Fufu, and Co. stop the jungle patterns of Nienna, Captain Ziplock, but that would be a real possibility for Curse to go aggressive into the jungle and force a 3-buff start.
And it looks like they're just going to go for the blue. They aren't going to have an invade here. nobody's collapsing on any of these sides that have the numbers advantage in their favor. And it's just going to be Baby Zeus versus ManCloud for a while.
Yeah, until the junglers unlock and start looking for ganks, which maybe it starts right now. Looks like it's not going to be the case. They're going to run back into their own jungle. Chris and Saint still farming out. Saint nearly level 3, which means Cocoon's coming. And that's when Elise starts getting real scary. Frank Fang Gaming just going to do the standard stuff.
3-minute dragon.
This is interesting because their jungler and top laner are around and the Morgana's down as well. They could contest this.
Yeah, it looks like that's what they're going to try to do here. If that lands, ooh! Yellow card is the only one that lands there. And now ManCloud, Chris, and Bunny Fufu all in route. They don't have Latman there to do consistent damage to this.
Too high
it's a level
health.
One Nien Tanso.
This is a giant risk for Academy.
You're
in a
contest.
Really good spot there. Stun comes out to Nien. Big damage. He's got to be careful. Flash heal used. Stays alive for now. Captain Zog must leave this one. And now Saint, very aggressive, looking for Baby Eater. Can he get the damage? Q comes out. One more attack. Yes, he can. And now Latman's in the wrong place. Frank Fang Gaming, why did you stay on Dragon?
That was an amazing call by Curse Academy. In their series against Coast, they lost every time they gave up the 3-minute dragon. So they come back and they say, we have strategized this. We know what we're going to do at 3 minutes so we don't give up the dragon. But can Ziploc steal it?
Don't. I guess he can try, but there's a gold card to zone him out. It's forced to Q over the wall. I don't think that's quite in Smite range from across, and he doesn't have a ward to put down anyway. So that's going to be the dragon picked up actually by Curse Academy. And Impactful's been freezing the top lane. 23 minions on him, and they've got 2 kills.
Look at how huge that gold swing was. They ended up giving up first blood. They get 2 kills, Dragon, and they get free CS onto Impactful, who just had a great game last game. And now, Frank Fang Gaming in a very bad spot very early on, but they look like they were in the position to make the right moves. Thing is, Curse Academy counters the typical move that you would make.
Yep.
It was very telegraphed.
Yeah.
That it's a 3-minute dragon. It's part of the meta.
Sure.
So you're countering the meta at this
point.
That's
what the early ward was for, right? They knew they were lane swapping towards top in this case. They put the ward down early game. And you put it down the second you leave base, and you're going to see the dragon attempt in time. So extremely well played and orchestrated by CA. I mean, and again, think about the fact that Bunny Fufu had to run down basically during wave 2.
Yeah, I'm really actually pleased with that.
Mm-hmm.
Because when I was watching the Curse Academy and Coast match, I was saying, like, somebody has to counter this. You can't just give up that dragon because it turns into wards, which turns into 7-minute buffs for the enemy team, which then transitions into the second dragon for your team.
Yep.
Because you get them late enough and you're like, oh, I still have the buff on me.
Yeah, exactly. It's all kinds of wonderful stuff. So Curse Academy do find the answer in that one. In this game, ends up being counter the dragon, because when it's this early on of a dragon, yes, you actually can 4v5.
Does so much damage.
Yeah, it just destroys people. So well played by them. Curse Academy looking a little bit better. ManCloud is down in XP against Baby Zeus because that guy never left his lane, but that's okay. To be honest, I'll take the gold. Gold card will land, and just some wild cards. Why the heck not? So Saint, early gold lead, Sight Stone, Spirit Stone there as well. Does get his trinket. Red one's out there. That's fine. And he's going to start getting some wards a little bit aggressively into the jungle. He'll be able to watch some of Captain Ziploc's moves. Not that one, but maybe the next one he makes. And he'll look to counter jungle this white. Camp sees him.
Yep.
And he has to run away.
A lot of pings coming out there from both sides.
Wow. That's
just freaking out.
All three of his Sightstone wards. St. Vicious now completely controls the Western jungle.
Yeah. Using all of the Sightstone to get himself that extra gold because he's just taking camps right now.
There's the smite, and he's taken away a camp. Now he's got to be a bit careful because he's still in enemy territory, but no one is really poised to stop this. Nicely done.
Nien Tanso proximity farming off behind the turret.
Just going to hurt him a little bit.
Shots.
This is actually a lot of his health.
That
was not exactly the best trade right here. He's going to try to get away. The knockup is there. Can he get it? Yes!
Nope.
The flash from Chris. I love it. Extremely well played.
Wow.
Yeah. I was so ready for that to be the play.
Nien Tanso just on the other side of
that
the
was
turret
silly.
Decides to walk straight through. There was no threat in the left side jungle either.
He saw
either.
Saint.
Yeah, he knew where Saint was on the complete other side of the map. So there was no risk in just going around. He cleared the wave and is using his TP to get back. He's up in CS too, but he just gave up a kill to Chris.
Yeah.
Who now has a level advantage over him. But only for a little while.
Lemon's got to be careful. Has a lantern, but loses half his health in the process.
Lantern man.
Safe.
Gets himself out of there. And St. Vicious is doing a really good job of keeping the vision up. And here's the thing, too, is when they have that deep of a vision, you know which side Vi is on, which allows ManCloud to make the perfect ganks with his teleport, or with his ultimate.
Oh, yeah.
You're just like, oh, Captain Ziploc's not even on this side of the map. I should use my ultimate and just go. Granted, it gives you vision of where he is in the first place, but you can set it up this way very easily.
Yeah, it prevents you from wasting the cooldown. Being, oh, never mind. Huh? Exactly. You don't have the fail condition really there. So good stuff by them. The wards will time out on the western side before too long, so Saint might have to re-up these or pick a different jungle pretty soon. But so far, so good. Baby Zeus continuing to wave clear, going towards the Athene's build. Same for Mancloud. That's all well and good. Mancloud actually missing part of the wave as he takes away the Wraith camp, so loses some CS for that play, but it's okay. Bloom up to Baby Zeus. And he's the only guy, I think, that's actually someone I would say is winning the lane.
Yeah.
Like, I know you've got CS for Niem, but you just gave a kill away. Like, Chris is going to do this kind of stuff.
Oh, he's going bottom.
Yep.
Can he get the knockup?
Walks forward. Nice play. And actually, no ulti available for Niem. He was stunned during the knockup there. Couldn't turn it back around. Nice skill picked up by Chris.
Yeah, and the wind wall was a little early there to block the gold card. But meanwhile, Baby Zeus is going to get free loving with this turret right here, seeing how much damage he can get down to it. But Saint's going to have none of that.
Yeah, he's going to do it again. Take some damage, though, to be fair. Yeah. But there's a shove into the turret. Niem Tanso's teleport is now down. He used it to get into lane last time. Ooh. So he is well behind.
Man, there's an eight. There's a 30 CS lead here for Impactful this early on in the game.
Yeah.
This is not good for Frank Fang Gaming in the overall, being this far down this early on. Curse Academy, you can tell, when you play a really good team like Team Coast,
yeah,
you end up going back to the drawing board and being like, okay, they pulled out a rock. We have to somehow invent paper.
Chris is about to be made of paper. Ooh. Gets cut down. Niem Tanso with the biggest scissors in the map. Takes him out. Cuts him in half. Ooh. Down he goes.
Snip, snip. And he's gone.
Gone. Back to the fountain or drawing board or whatever it takes to respawn a dragon.
But yeah, as I was saying, it basically makes you invent something new. And now...
Well, Saint's going to get out of the jungle, but he's got to be careful. Knock up. Will it land?
Uses the flash.
Ignite the Q. The damage comes out. Nicely done. Baby Zeus actually saves his ulti still. Mancloud does have flash.
There's a red
he's
buff
taken
too,
red
yeah.
buff damage. But it lands. Captain Ziploc not going to chase it down.
Dragon is in 14 seconds as well. If they get to the dragon immediately by Frank Fang Gaming, they can start it up and get it because Saint will be nowhere near in time. But it looks like that isn't the move right now. Niem Tanso is actually going to go top. His teleport isn't up just yet, whereas Chris's is.
It's nearly up. I think by the time anyone contests for a dragon, I think we'll be okay.
Very close.
Do like the fact both teams realized, yep, teleport's imminent or now. Be top lane because we know we need to contest Dragon. If you're in a dual lane there, Dragon's gone. You might as well kiss it goodbye. So both teams do identify that, look, even with a 1,000 gold deficit, Frank Fang Gaming can and should contest this. And so the teams are in the correct spots to do so. Baby Eater still equal over the Bunny Fufu. Nice bind. Latman only one level down on Impactful and still trying to get that BT going. Mm.
I do have to say that Curse Academy, they have more pick potential in their comp, whereas Frank Fang Gaming is really Niem Tanso reliant in terms of their team fight.
Oh, Latman started to channel a Q and took a whole bunch of damage.
Here, though.
This is bad for him. Has to heal and flash away. That's a lot.
That's a dragon. If they go straight for it, that is a dragon right there. They got the AD carry out, and he doesn't have any lifesteal just yet.
And here we go. The aggro's there. Yeah, this is going to be 100% there. The gold deficit for Latman. Almost 30 CS at this point in the game. And that's with Impactful leaving the lane to take a dragon. That is a very, very, very rough start here for this Frank Fang Gaming squad, especially their AD carry. Thankfully, they don't necessarily need to rely on Kate to win the game. Niem is still farming quite well. Baby Zeus is actually the highest CS in the game.
So this pinch behind him, and they're going to gank him.
He's not a good spot. Budge's easy comes out, finding. Yeah, that's a kill picked up. Mancloud claims that one for himself. Level 9. And man, Curse Academy, just keep finding these picks. The Twisted Fate, I'll take my word back, is working exceptionally well.
Yeah. Saint is having a really good game this game, too. Just like last game. Coming up really big for himself. Alongside Chris, basically all Curse Academies, they're having a really good game right now. Ziploc, he had a great game last game, and he's having a good one this time, too.
Chris, a little aggressive on this one.
His ulti's about to be up, though.
They're not going
to
chase it.
And they don't chase it.
They don't want to chase through the burnout. It does mean Chris loses some CS, but who really cares? Mid lane turret was under fire the whole time. Baby Zeus being dead, and Captain Ziploc going top. Curse Academy said, great, pressure top, show up mid, take that one down, and now they're all running down the jungle for bot lane.
They have to see this coming too. They're about to come over a ward. And actually, no, they ping it out instead. And they're going to go ahead and sit in their pink ward bush.
Oh, man. Curse Academy looking to get even more than they could have.
Oh, they're looking for the pick.
Oh no, Captain Ziplock, don't do it. ABZ is also in the wrong spot. They've got to be real careful. No wait, Captain Ziplock kept chasing!
Whoa, it's going
Why
camp.
Did you go into that team? Damage coming out. He's got the ulti though. Can they win this fight anyway? Actually, this could be good for FrankFang Gaming. St. Vision now in the box. Ignite is on Latman. Put some good damage down. That's one for FrankFang Gaming. They've turned it around. They've got the damage on a Bunny Fufu. Chris also forced to run away. The Vi ulti, the big damage comes out. Chris! Also going to fall. Would you look at that? Two kills picked up. Loses the turret, but hey.
Wow.
FrankFang Gaming back on the map.
Yeah, that was a crazy play there. Captain Ziplock, it looked like no one was around, but the teleport came in and the collapse from all angles. He's not very tanky at all. He doesn't have a single tank item, yet he lasted so long off of the wild growth from Baby Zeus and the lantern, which helped him get out at the last second. Watch that again here. Look, there's like almost nobody around it, but they collapse all at the same time. He ends up getting wild growth. They aren't able to use the Yasuo ultimate off of it just yet, but then they go ahead and they just kite backwards. Now Nian Tanso teleports into the top part of this fight while Latman is kiting backwards. They end up going 2-0 in the overall. They do lose the turret for it, but it's what they needed.
Well, I actually want to know what the calling was there for Curse Caddy, because Impactful spent that entire time pushing bottom lane out of turret. He did not show. That was a literal 4v5 team fight the entire way through. Now, if the call was, guys, we lost the fight, just let it go, then I understand. If Impactful just like didn't show up to a battle two screens away, that's a problem.
The gold is still 2k in favor of Curse Academy, though, so cut it a little bit closer, but the turret's going to go ahead and make up for it.
Yeah.
May have been at the point where it was like, okay, we might be done here. Mm-hmm. So the fact that he didn't show up beforehand, because that would have had to be some premeditation. You would have had to been like, yeah, we're going to fight in the jungle, and they're totally gonna
face check us.
Yeah, they're gonna like, they did face check him.
Yep.
But it was really well played there by all of FrankFang Gaming. Just having Baby Zeus make Captain Ziplock very tanky for a short period of time was all they needed.
It worked out. I mean, you're missing your AD carry. TF is not the highest damage source really in the game. Like Vi has some tank stats, like from runes and masteries rather. Not.
Yes.
I mean, of course, from the item build, but hey. Junglers tend to build fairly durable.
He's going for a second offensive item, too. And now Nian Tanso, he's getting ganked.
All right, well, here's the attempt. Can he outplay this? The knockup is available. Windwalt, nice. Blocks the gold card. Knockup goes for the ulti as well. Gets away from the cocoon. On top of this, there's the wild growth. Can they get the damage through? They will at least force Curse Academy to disengage.
Oh.
And there's Ziplock going in for Mancloud. Another knockup. And the kill comes through. Nian flashes out. Chris comes back in. He's juking back and forth. Gets the wind. Back up on the double kill now for Captain Ziplock. FrankFang Gaming finding all kinds of things.
Oh, Baby's on the wrong side of this, but he's going to slow them.
Ooh, this is pretty good though, maybe. Knock up. Bunny Fufu goes in, but this is an outnumbered fight, Curse Academy.
Oh,
still
going to
land the damage. Two kills picked up. Make that three kills picked up. Now Baby's use goes down. The fights just keep going back and forth.
It's a 4-on-5 in the overall, because Latman wasn't involved in that fight. They end up going 4-for-2. It was a crazy fight. Nian Tanso at the start, he plays this extremely well. He waits for the gold card. He ends up putting down the wall. He blocks both. Dodges the cocoon by using his last breath and puts him on the opposite side. And now Mancloud forced to flash away, but takes it with him. And they end up picking up Mancloud. He flashes away, goes straight back through Chris. Comes out. They end up getting Saint. The big thing here, though, is Bunny Fufu's ultimate. You're going to watch it here. Ends up getting the binding. Uses the black shield. Flashes in. Gets all of them. Baby Zeus breaks the tether, but it's not long enough for everybody else, and they all just get stunned up.
Yeah.
Everybody that was in that fight for FrankFang Gaming died.
Yeah. I mean, they made the fundamental mistake of running away from Morgana. You don't chase Singe, but you also don't run from Morgulti. It never turns out well for you.
Yeah.
And they all got stunned up. They all died, and it was a really...
Especially in a bottleneck like that, there's only really one direction for them to run in. To try and get away, and it's so easy for Bunny Fufu to predict that direction and just start walking that way.
Exceptionally well played. Baby Zeus, though, didn't see that one coming. Cocoon's gonna land as well. Damage comes through, but the lantern lights the way home. He's gonna be all right for this one. Curse Academy, though, sitting on a 4,500 gold lead. Make that closer to just 4,000. Nian is pushing the top lane, 125 minions on him. Despite his difficulties fighting Chris in some of these matchups, he is acquiring farm.
Yeah, he's their way back in this game. If they can set up an ultimate on him once he gets those items he needs for the damage and the last breath. See what they can do with that. Dragon is up in 20 seconds. Nian Tanso will have his teleport around that time, but Mancloud, he has something to say about it.
He looks for it. Nian again. The wild cards cannot drop the gold card, though. Damage on Impactful has the knockup. Gets one, gets the ulti. Does he have the pain required? No, he does not. Impactful claims the kill. Killing spree. 3-0-2 on Corki.
So last time that Mancloud went top, he used his auto attack at the same time he used the wild cards. Mm-hmm. So Niantonsu just threw out the wind wall at the wild cards. This time, he said, you have to eat one of these, whether it's the wild card or the yellow card. Throws out the wild cards, baits the wind wall, and then walks up and throws the yellow card for the stun.
That was exactly, well, that was like perfectly played right there by ManCloud. Good job on that one to bait the spell out. Curse Academy get all the way back down to the bottom side of that, despite committing two guys topside, and then they go for the dragon. They pick that one up, so even more advantages. Curse Academy up 3 kills. They're up a turret, and they've got the most recent dragon.
Yeah, they're just making picks all of the time here with Curse Academy's team composition. It does have some team fight behind it. We saw it with Bunny Fufu. But Frank Fan Gaming, they're pretty one-dimensional in what they do.
Yep.
It's, we're going to fight you. We're going to fight you with Niantonsu. If Niantonsu gets picked off before the fight even starts,
no fight.
We've lost pretty much our linchpin in the strategy.
Oh, they're going to look for it, though. Ulti comes across Bunny Fufu. Nice binding, but one hit from dead. The Q comes out. Latman claims the kill. Puts him at 1-1-3. So Frank Fan Gaming finally finding life back on their AD carry because they've been getting crushed by Impactful comparatively.
Once again, it's another outnumbered fight here. Impactful, he's just going to push bottom now.
Wow, they're actually picking up the defend tier 2 mid. I would just hit the turret if I were Impactful at this point. He could duel Latman when he shows up. He actually looks for the flank in the... Nope. Looks for the attempt in the jungle. Won't go for the red buff either. Now he's got to be careful because there are enemy champions afoot. Thresh with Boots of Moby. Not going to find anything. So mid-outer turret actually gets picked up thanks to that that kill. Frank Fan Gaming now tie up this turret score. They bring the gold back within just about 3,000.
Look at that. 1,300 gold more for Impactful over Latman on that Corki. What can Nian do?
He's going to get the knockup. Cannot claim ManCloud, though, and that is another kill picked up. Wrong place at the wrong time. And they got to be careful. Ooh,
are they
going to
get more off of it?
Yeah, it looks like going to be safe, but it does mean they have control over the blue buff area. Captain Ziplock did already claim that one anyway. He did get his jungle before they all left. So nothing big to claim Curse Academy unless they get turrets or they set up a Baron.
And it looks like turret is going to be the answer here. See what they can do. Impactful just pushing up, but the wave clear from Latman is there.
Jeez. These bindings keep hitting. Bunny's got really good bindings this game.
He's got really good skill shots. His Thresh is just phenomenal, as well as his Morgana. You have to be really good with those as a support.
Oh, yeah.
That's all you really have to your name.
Yeah.
It's funny, too, because he sets up St. Vicious. St. Vicious is usually throwing the cocoon afterwards instead of before.
Yeah.
So it's the binding setting up the cocoon, not the other way around.
And it's working exceptionally well for these guys, I got to say. Impressive stuff all around by Curse Academy. 303 on their AD carry. 216 on Bunny Fufu. He's going to look at Niantonsu. Walks backwards. No big deal. Swags it out as Morgana.
Yeah. And there's a lot on the line here. This is the automatic berth back into the round of 8 in Challenger. If Curse Academy win this, they don't have to go back to the rank 5s. Frank Fang win this, they get another chance. And they bring it to 3 games. It's a very tense situation for these players. Yeah. And you can see it's not letting them down on their bloodlust, though. They're going very hard.
They're saying, okay, we might lose this game. Kill people.
Now
okay.
We're nothing.
That's a good way back in. We want to win the game. Kill people. Great. That's a good way to close the game.
They both kind of have the same mentality. Just Curse Academy are playing the objective game better.
Yep. That's true. Absolutely true. Curse Academy have definitely managed to find their way around this map. Ziplock. Uh-oh. ManCloud damage. Oh, gosh. Gold cards there. Locks that one up. Got to be careful about the ulti.
Still available.
Nice.
Ooh, it gets the cooldown, too.
And the flash due to dodge the Q. ManCloud still trying to make the outplay. Here comes the Niantonsu, though. Well played. Pretty much everybody.
Yeah. Got the ultimate, the assault and battery out, and broke it with the Zhonya, so it puts both of them on cooldown. A little bit of a win there for ManCloud in that regard.
All right, he's going to lose both his summoners for that one, but hey.
Yeah.
No Vi ulti means you got more time to go make the plays you want to make elsewhere here, and there's nothing easily forced for Frank Fan Gaming anymore.
A win in style points, I'll put it that way.
Oh, that's for sure.
Yeah. Not a win in summoner spells.
That's fine. You don't always need summoner spells.
And we talked about that earlier.
Yeah.
How much
five
value?
Gold.
How much value? He doesn't even get 5 gold for that one.
He does get a Vi ulti cooldown.
Yes.
Sometimes means more than flash.
That's true. It's about to be up very shortly, though.
Just out of range.
And we'll see Bunny Fufu. It's usually his job to block it with the black shield. There's 2 minutes on dragon. But most of the dragons are just falling into Curse Academy's hands because they're playing the map better a minute in advance.
They are. Oh, run 2 minutes in advance of the dragon. You're going to see the word control will probably start now for Curse Academy. Bot lane's already pushed out. They've got a pink ward in enemy territory. They've actually swept away most of the wards in that scenario. Just barely missed that one. So fortunate.
Chris is prioritizing armor over everything else. Three items about to be dedicated to it with the boots alongside them. Mm-hmm. Because he's like, Captain Ziploc, Niantonso, Latman. I don't care about Baby Zeus. I don't care about Lulu's persistent damage. I want to tank turrets, too, and that's exactly what they're going
to
do here.
Darn straight. It's the right choice. Curse Academy want to go for this turret. Hook's going to land on a St. Vish Cocoon. Binding lands as well. Burst comes out. Maybe they're half HP, even lower now. Gets the Wild Growth. Turret goes down. No love lost from Curse Academy. Well done.
Now, Niantonso, a little far up there. But instead, they're going to go ahead and rotate down bottom for Curse Academy. They are going to start warding up this area and prepare for the dragon and the route that Frank Fan Gaming would be taking into that area.
All right, we're going to look for this bottom lane. Yes, indeed. Niantonso gets a shield and a whimsy. Stay safe.
There's just so much to lock him up, too, though. Between Morgana, yeah. Twisted Fate, and Elise.
Oh, same vision on the wrong side of this battle. The Manclash doesn't try to help. Impactful jumps the wall, gets flayed in, has to flash backwards, but there comes the end. I don't know if you're in the right spot for that one, Impactful. Still trying to kite out. He does go down. That was greedy. Three kills now for Frank Fang Gaming. They've only lost Nien so far. Ziploc does cut around on this one. Now only Chris and Manclash left alive. Will they re-engage on top of all this? Hook's not going
to
land.
But look at how hard it is for them to do anything when Niantonso is down. Mm-hmm. It is very difficult. He is the linchpin of this strategy and this composition. There's 10 seconds, 8 seconds on the dragon currently, and they aren't actually going to go for it from Frank Fang. Instead, they're going to back off so they don't have to worry about Mancloud's poke.
Well, Mancloud's going to poke away these minions for now, though. Looks like they're going to give him the room to kill this wave off. Not too much going for this one. See that fight again, and just watch Corki, though.
Yeah, Corki in the back, though, jumps straight over, but here's the knockup from Niantonso, hits both of them.
Yeah.
They get a black shield a little late on Impactful, so he actually does eat the knockup. They end up flashing and getting the kill, but man, on the overall, 3-for-1 puts 4k gold in Curse Academy's favor still. And they're going to get a dragon off of it again. Frank Fan Gaming, they aren't playing the dragon game. Niantonso went top.
Wow, they couldn't even try for that one. So out they go. The kill score, very close to the thing. FFG obviously have ways to pick up champion kills, but you're seeing...
Ooh, Nien once pain. Again.
Nice. With respect to the win mode, they didn't even throw a gold card. Which means he got out, though,
yeah.
To be fair.
There's a large wave top currently. Dragon, once again, falling to Curse Academy, won't be on the map for a while. Now Baron is what you set up for this late in the game at the 25-minute mark. Clearing it out, there's no wards here for Frank Fang Gaming, and there's always the possibility Curse Academy has started it up. So now, Frank Fang, they have to play perfectly.
Oh, Corki got that one. He outsmited Captain Ziploc. That's not good for these guys. Blue buff on Corki is a great tool to have. Infinite Rockets is always nice. Curse Academy are setting up the Baron bait. They're waiting on the other side of the wall. Baby Eater, yeah, good luck killing this ward without getting binded.
Watch the binding.
He's trying to bait the bind.
Oh, he warded over.
Okay,
they
cool.
They let him ward over. He doesn't even get the ward. He didn't even get to kill the ward.
He was just, oh, I like that. That was the original. Oh, gosh, watch out. Okay, Cocoon on the Niantonso. Chris is around. He's got to be careful, though. This is a big risk there. Latman does have a red buff. Nien's shield's going to keep him safe. There's the engage in. Onwards, Bunny Fufu. Damage comes through from the Kate ulti. Latman still all right. Two item Corki, two item Caitlyn.
There's no pink wards here for Curse Academy either, is a big thing. Once these wards get down in their territory, their sweepers are mostly on cooldown. They're going to have to use them in the right spots.
And they have to guess and or remember where they all came down because they don't have perfect vision control. Even still, Frank Fan Gaming actually still have their own defensive pink ward to get rid of enemy wards there. This one's actually going to be kept alive, I think.
They use their body for it.
Yeah, it happens. Niantonso just going to jump over the wall. Nice wind wall keeps that all safe. But Frank Fan Gaming are now finally getting pushed out. Looks like the poke a little bit better for Curse Academy.
Yeah, it's definitely better for Curse Academy. Their pick potential between the Cocoon, the yellow card, all that stuff I mentioned before, and the threat of Bunny Fufu flashing into your team with a Soul Shackle is very high. And they're going to go for it.
And
look
he
at
goes
that.
For it. Look at that one. Pop the zones when you need to. Yes, he does. That's going to be fine. Impactful finds one. But if you go on top of the box, he goes down to Yasuo. 1-for-1 so far.
Oh, he gets the knockup.
Knockup goes in. They find Impactful. That's 2-for-1 so far. Saint goes down. Look at this. Frank Fan Gaming, the better team fight comp by a lot.
And Mandatory Cloud, he's just going to get himself out of there. And now they're in a position to do Baron. Latman has a lot of HP. Niantonso is actually taking a decent amount of damage from this. But here comes the poke over the wall. They don't have ward control. Can he dodge it?
Oh, Baby Zeus real low on health right now. But Captain Ziploc does tank this out successfully. Mancloud just going to recall. Looks like this will be safe. And Frank Fang Gaming, they find the team fight. They get the Baron after, and they're within 2,000 gold.
Yeah, they are back in this. They are actually up in combat stats for a little while. We'll have to see what they do with it, because Niantonso, he's hitting those power spikes with his items, where because they centered so much of the team around him, this is just like a Protect the Kog'Maw composition, where if your linchpin's gone, you can't do anything. But if they put a focus on somebody else and he just stays alive the entire time and he gets items, then it's devastating. Right now, it's pretty much Niantatsu is very squishy. If they use their CCs on a different member and they don't keep him locked up and they get the right engage like they did there, then it just goes in their favor pretty much 9 out of 10 times.
Yeah, and you're seeing it time and again. I mean, we already identified FFG could get champion kills.
Yes.
They were so close in kills the entire time, even when they were down 5,000 gold.
Frankfurt Gaming's team fight is better. Curse Academy has more pick. If they can pick Niantatsu off, that's their win condition. Mm-hmm. But if Frankfurt Gaming get a full-on just fight, they're going to be in great shape, especially since Ziploc is now getting to that tanky point after building two offensive items.
Yeah, and remember what we talked about before as well with Curse Academy. They have not shown that they call well from behind.
Yes.
That they start.
They're still ahead.
Really
a little.
Yeah, but here's the thing, right? Is they have lost so many fights in a row now. They've lost Baron control. They don't know. They don't know the total amount of gold on the map. They know they're down in kills. They know they're down a Baron. They know they're losing team fights. If Arco's got to be like, shoot, we're losing this game right now.
Yeah.
And from that mindset, we haven't seen them do very well.
That's true. ManCloud, probably out of everybody, is still in the lead mindset currently because of how well he's been doing. And they're going to go pick Niantatsu off again.
Windwall, not going to do enough. There we go.
Look at the
Flash
damage.
Use, big damage comes out. Do they have enough, though? Chris puts a slowdown, but there's Baby Zeus to save the team. And here's the reinforcements, though. They kill off the minions. There's no Caitlyn, but they don't stay for the turret.
Batman is so far away from this fight. They decide not to stay for the turret. They had no vision of her when she started to come up. Vision is very scarce in the jungle now of Frankfurt Gaming because Curse Academy got beaten off of that area when they went to go after Baron. And now, ooh.
I'm
going to push straight up the mid here versus Curse Academy. Last time Frankfurt Gaming lost a base race.
Right,
and they're
going
to challenge it again? Niantatsu's
staying.
Against
the Curse sister team, Lulpro and Curse Academy. There's the recalls coming out, Frankfurt Gaming.
Niantatsu's going to stay. Can he windwall the turret, though?
Okay.
And stop it from taking
Latman
damage.
Takes a tier 2 turret, and down goes the inhibitor. Curse Academy making the much better choice there. Latman should just keep hitting things. There we go. Goes for the inhibitor turret.
If they can stop the backs, though, but at the same time, if you try to stop backs and you dedicate too many...
That's a little bit of a risk right there. Niantatsu gets the ult, he gets back out, but Captain Ziploc went in. Now you're in the wrong spot. He does have Flash. He misses it. Ult's back across the wall, though. There we go. Back into this one. Ziploc, what? He lives, and now St. Vicious is going to be going down. Latman's still pushing the base. That's the inhibitor turret going down. Nian takes a binding. Black Shield is on Buddy Fufu. He's going to go down. More kills keep getting picked up. You've got to be careful for ManCloud now. Oh my gosh. Kills left and right. The shields. Baby Zeus versus Impactful. Impactful wins it. Niantatsu has the path of shield. But
Chris.
There comes Chris, and Chris gets him. Wow. Okay, so inhibit goes down. Kills everywhere. 3v3, I think.
Ziploc, he's looking for more, though.
Right. All right, impactful. Oof. Gotta be careful.
So close. Okay. Has Valkyrie.
There's a chance that Valkyrie fails. That was good. He clicked that one right. Now he's gonna be careful.
Movement speed, a little bit in favor, but...
You should land an auto attack.
Oh, Latman's here.
All right.
Okay,
impactful's dead.
Yeah.
All right, so Frankfurt Gaming.
Wow, okay.
They go plus a kill and plus an inhibitor.
Yeah.
In that fight.
Really big for them. Dragon is up, though. So who gets there? Who ends up taking that for themselves? It's a very expensive dragon at this point in the game, being 31 minutes in and everybody being around that level 15 area. Have to see what happens here, because Super Minion's pushing down the mid lane now for Frankfurt Gaming. And Bunny...
He comes in. He's still got Zonya's Baby Eater. Is definitely not going to be in a good spot right there. Burst comes out. He might not even go down right there. Bunny Fufu neglected to bind after the stun hit, and Baby Eater stays alive. Yasuo goes in. Down goes St. Vicious.
Oh!
There we go. Picked up another one to go. Goes on towards the Morgana. Now Dragon being attacked, and Frankfang Gaming keep making the right choice.
I think this is their first Dragon of the game.
Oh my god.
That they've been able to get for themselves, and now it puts them in the lead.
Wow.
Just their team fighting is so much better than Curse Academy's, and they're trying to pick people off, but they have these tools that stop them from being picked. You have the Thresh Lantern, you have Lulu saving people, and then you have so much knockup and just threats on your so many threats on your team.
Yeah.
Is what's happening here for Frankfang Gaming when they're reaching this late game. Niantatsu, when he's getting that 100% crit build, he does so much damage when he actually gets into the fight. Baby Zeus just saves people flat out because of his extra AP and wild growth. A lot is culminating here. They bought so much time for themselves. You just have to group at this point.
So we look at the gold right here. You can see the Captain Ziploc is gigantic compared to Saint Vicious.
He's not backing right now. Okay. So if you haven't seen Frank Fan Gaming before, they love to sit in these bushes for a very long time because they don't have a pick comp, but they will play it like a pick comp.
They have Thresh. Good enough.
Okay. They'll be like, you. I choose you.
Press Q. Hit him.
Yeah.
Guy dies.
But they'll sit there for so long. They'll give up experience. They'll give up waves. But this is their style. They like to bait people. And it looks like Chris, is he going to bite the hook and take the bait?
He missed it. You can tell if that hits people.
Yeah, you can. But if you watched any of the replays,
yeah, you know that.
You would know this style from Frank Fan Gaming. Because they love sitting in that bush. Bearing up in a minute. So because they sat in that bush for so long, they're giving up Baron vision control. They don't have a lot of time to wrestle that back for themselves.
So Curse Academy actually right now have version 1 vision control over Baron Nashor. They are up 1-0 in the series. They can turn this game back to their favor. They're taking third place. They're moving on to series 2 as a pre-qualified team. And that's really good for your chance of qualifying for the LCS. Frank Fan Gaming had a very disappointing game 1. A very disappointing start to game 2. Found a way to come back from behind. Their teamfight comps are awesome. Nien got Yasuo. That's already a good point.
Then we talk about Nien Tanso so much. Captain Ziploc is one of the unsung heroes of this team. I talk about he actually had a pretty good game 1. He was going crazy at the start of the game up against Saint. They both had really good kill participation. And this game, he's 6-1 and 13. He's been involved in 19 out of these 21 kills.
Yeah, that's...
He's
impressive.
Right alongside there with Baby Zeus, and Nien Tanso is just a little bit back more. They are to team fight comp through and through. They like to group up, they like to fight, and here's the Baron, Chris Bottom, so he won't be involved in the start of the fight unless he starts it off with a TP. So there's a timer on this Baron. Look at that. Will Ziploc go over?
Timer on FFG. Latman looks for the ulti, not going to put it down just yet. Poke won't land at a Saint either. Baby Eater waits in this brush. I like that. Good ward, they're going to push him off this one. They've started Baron, though. Teleport comes in as well from Shyvana, and FFG backs off with the TP cooldown. Now burned. Chris, 5 minutes to wait for this one.
And now, the Summoner's Rift standoff. Sitting around each other, seeing who gets the right engage, who lands the binding, who gets the door in.
Binding is used already and goes in for Saint Vicious. Ulti pop, they get a couple of guys now. Re-engage comes in. Ziploc, he goes down right away. The backline is huge for Curse Academy, but you gotta watch out though. Bunny Foo for taking a whole bunch of pain. Latman is big as well. And the health bars are so low from Curse Academy. Baby Eater, hook hits impactful. Will he chase it down? No, he won't. Binding comes out for the disengage. Summoner heal used. Mancloud gets it up. Latman! Oh, down goes the AD carry. Nien Tanso forced to flash away. This could be the fight for either team. And right now, Curse Academy getting one extra kill on it. Now where can they go?
Both teams lost their tanky frontliner, and then it was all the squishies left, and now Curse Academy, they're going straight down the mid lane. They have a big wave to clear out here, but they have a wave coming up behind them.
Oh man, this is actually looking pretty good for Curse Academy. They don't have a lot of health on Bunny Fufu, but oh, they go back towards Baron.
Better to do that right now. But at the same time, no. Actually, Blue is the safest play here because you won't have your jungler around for a little bit. Ziploc will be in the area. Also, you have two members who are low. And Frank Fan Gaming, when they show up, they'll all be 100% HP.
Windwall, the face check, and they say, you know what? Okay, they didn't do Baron. Frank Fan Gaming definitely looking to see if that did happen. The answer was no.
Nobody's upgraded their trinket to an Oracle's Lens just yet for Frank Fan Gaming Curse Academy.
Oh, they are trying to rush down Baron, but Curse Academy are ready for this one. Of course, no one went bot lane. Smart choice there. Nien is around, but he's taking a lot of pain.
Nien's not there.
Shields come out. Nien could die right here. You've got to be careful. Chris is around. No dragon form just yet. Shields being burned. Saint goes in. He's got to be real careful. Nien staying alive. Well,
oh, he gets impactful.
He gets the re-engage. Impactful's got to be careful. He goes down to Captain Ziploc. Chris and Saint still on the chase. The wind wall. The damage. The knockbacks. Nien gets another one. Now Chris in the mix, but he gets hooked backwards. Nien gets another knockup.
They can't get Nien Tanso.
DF ulti comes in. Nien still juking back and forth. More kills picked up. Mancloud finds Latman. Is that going to be enough? Binding doesn't even need to hit right there. And they find a 1-for-3. Still Frank Fan Gaming's favor. Mancloud dodges the stun.
Oh my god!
Binding hits, and Mancloud finds another kill. These fights!
Back
keep
and
going
forth
back.
And back and forth. Now he's just going to block these bindings. Good on Baby Eater for that one. Mancloud, he has Lich Bane though. He will get this turret fairly quickly.
That's the best that you can get. Very smart choice. Yeah. Very smart choice, Mancloud. Best thing he could do here. That will be Baron. The recall also coming in. From BB Eaters. Actually, no, he's actually in a duel with Bunny Fufu. Bunny Fufu wants to stop recalls, and he will do so, actually. So, actually, there are no backstage yet. Bunny Fufu will Zonias and die for this, but with that stun, maybe he gets out. Oh my gosh, are you serious? Can he get away from Nien? He's trying. Juke correctly. Doesn't see... Oh, okay, he's gone. But he stopped recalls for a long time. Mancloud got back to base. A big wave actually hitting some of the Nexus turrets here.
Yeah, there's some big power spikes, though, for Nian Tanso and the rest of his team in team fights. There's... so hard to get to him.
And wow.
Yeah, he survived for so long, that fight. Nian Tanso coming up really big there, alongside Captains of Block. I feel bad for Latman, because he starts this fight at the base. He comes up, and when he gets there, he gets picked off by Mancloud, who's on the bottom right-hand side of this fight the entire time. Nian Tanso, he's kiting backwards. He gets the knock-up on Impactful, the right person for them. Impactful has to flash to the right. They pick him up. The flashes, the heals on Nian Tanso, the wild growth, the shields. Now, if you look at the map, Latman just shows up to the fight now. And he's like, oh, by the way, Mancloud's on the other side of you, and he picks him off.
Yep.
Like, Latman did nothing that fight except run into it.
Yeah, Mancloud ults and is like, I'm going to kill you.
Yeah.
And this, this is a great outplay, too. I love this one.
Oh, he dodges the Glitter Lance off of the help picks, and then just uses the red buff and the cooldown reduction, just gold cards, and plays that perfectly for Mancloud, picking up a much-needed inhibitor for his team. They are neck and neck right now.
So 68,000 per team. 46 kills in this game at 38 minutes. Both teams have killed an inhibitor at some point. The mid inhibitors respawn for Curse Academy.
Nian now has Guardian Angel. So he, not only is it hard to kill him now because he just kites backwards and his team is all over him, protecting him, it's really hard to kill him again.
Yeah, it is. Oh man. Banshee's Veil done for Baby Eater too, so he's actually getting pretty durable. Still gets pop, but who cares?
They have to get this fairly quickly because they have super minions pushing top.
Yeah, Curse Academy, how long can you hold this? Because you will require someone to answer that top lane soon. I mean, that's such a big wave. That would kill the Nexus on its own.
Yes. It's a very, very,
very
large
near
wave.
To it. And big in fact, wave bot as well.
Double super minions are very, very easy to take those turrets, especially the side ones.
As soon as they win a fight, Chris could either TP top, close the game, he could TP bottom and get maybe a couple turrets off that.
I'm ticking right now. They ping it. Because they see that huge monster wave coming.
FFG back off. That's the right choice.
Yeah, they have to.
He gets sucked into one bad fight and the game ends.
It's going to tick away at their Baron. And it's going to open up a little bit for Curse Academy. But in the overall, it is the correct move. Because otherwise you lose the game just by pushing.
It's
They didn't force it either.
The upside's not that high.
Yeah, exactly. They didn't force it either.
They may lose it anyway.
No, they're going to lose
it. Oh my gosh. They did not react in time. Turret goes down regardless. FrankFan Gaming not respecting the minion wave whatsoever. That is really rough for FrankFan Gaming. Gives Curse Academy a whole bunch more time. You're seeing all the other waves already pushing in. So map control just goes to Curse Academy right now.
Yeah, the fact that it's a side wave and double super minions, they will focus just one turret. If it's the middle one, they kind of split between two.
Yeah, they can.
But on this one, just focus that top turret down. It's a really bad sign there for the reaction and the calling of FrankFan Gaming. They overstayed their welcome. I thought it would be fine, but no, turns out it wasn't. And now here comes another wave. It's not a double super minion just yet.
But I like that he will like sort of face things by windwalling it. Just be like,
well,
there was the binding.
He had vision there, but he was just like, I have to do this.
Okay, well, the TF ulti goes mid. The split push, actually, the gameplay for Curse Academy looks like Baron buff. Soon timing out here. Zephlock wants to move forward.
Yeah.
Smartly goes back.
Whew. They saw that Mancloud used his ultimate. He went middle, but Latman was there. Their persistent damage that they need in these fights. Because if Nian Tanso, he just gets set up by everybody and he's the main threat. You kind of need that secondary threat who's constantly doing damage, and it's like, oh, we can't focus Nian Tanso 100% because Latman does a ton of damage.
Fair. So top and hip has respawned. No more super minions left on the maps. That will fend for itself pretty successfully. I don't see it building up a big wave that can't be defended on its own, so that should be all right. Mancloud chooses to recall here. Of course, Athene's Twisted Fate at level 18 does have a fairly short ulti cooldown, so it'll be about 42 minutes, maybe a little bit more. But not too long afterwards, so we'll have the next attempt at Destiny coming in.
And look at that, Latman. I mean, sorry, Impactful. He now has a Warden's Mail in his inventory, and he's looking to try and just survive against Nian Tanso for as long as he possibly can.
It's interesting. It's the choice between Randuin and GA.
There's a lot of Randuins coming out here.
I would personally do Randuin or Guardian Angel over Randuin's just because the damage output's so high. Randuin's doesn't really save you, from my experiences. That said, I'll watch a team fight where he lives with 40 health, and I'm like, never mind, you were right all along. but we'll, yeah, I want to see how this pays out right now. Impactful still. going to do the best wave clear he can. At some point, he could also sell Triforce for PD for a damage bump, but that's secondary to him actually getting a defensive item, so no rush on that guy. Nia going to hold the bottom lane. I feel like Chris will actually have a really hard time fighting the end right now.
Yes.
And so he's got to give a lot of respect to that champion.
Yeah, the big thing is if Nien can get a last breath off and then just shred through him. Or Van Cloud comes.
Well, they're looking for that lane. He does not get the wind wall. This is not good for Nien. Big Burst comes out. GA is popped. Ziplock is around. Can they get in on Man Cloud or anything else? You've got Saint around there as well.
They want to get Nien gone.
Not good for Nien, but they get the Lantern. The Cocoon hits him, though. The Wild grows. He can't get out except for Flash. And there comes Buddy with a massive ulti, and they blew up Nien. One for nothing. Now Ziplock locks up. 2-0. Saint Fish has got to be careful, though. Black Shield is on, repels the air. Baby Eater goes down. 3-0. Curse Academy. They find the picks, and they find three of them.
Bunny's taking so much damage from this turret, though.
Ooh, the summoner heal keeps him safe, though. Bottom tier 2 turret goes down. And in the 5v2, what else can they get?
Yeah, three members of Frankfin Gaming are down right now with 40-second death timers. They're pushing up the base with a Lich Bane Man Cloud.
They flash in, Baby Zeus goes down. Now it's only Latman. He gets exploded. Double kill for Impactful. That could certainly be the game. And Curse Academy, fighting tooth and nail for 44 minutes, have found their way into the base. The minions are here. There are no respawns, and they will take the third place match 2-0, and they earned it.
And Frankfin Gaming, they have to go back to the ladder to requalify and keep their points for Summer Series 2.
Yeah.
Curse Academy, third place. They get that extra point. They get an auto berth into the round of 8, and they played that very well. They knew their win condition was pick Nien off. Said it multiple times, and they do it there at the very end with Man Cloud. Didn't play the wind wall correctly.
Yeah.
Ends up eating the gold card. It was funny because the lantern came out and actually Ziplock took it from Nien. Nien ended up having to walk straight through, but Bunny Fufu was already there, and he even locked up Ziplock. So it didn't really matter. They were just pinched him around in the perfect way possible. And really, when you realize your win conditions like that against this team, you're like, let's just execute it. Let's just do it.
Yeah.
Just get Nien, and then what else does the rest of the team do? Because they built the composition around him.
Yeah, and it's funny, too. I mean, I'm thinking about all the things that happened in this game. You mentioned Bunny Fufu's Flash Morgana ulties. 2 seconds later, he did it, which I thought was great.
Yeah.
I love the karma there on that one.
Karma?
Shut up. I know. I hate you a little bit, but no, that's something I would do, so I feel you. But yeah, like, he played awesome. Like, they stole the threshold, but his Morgana was freaking great. The bindings were amazing. The Black Shields, a few were late, to be fair, but the ulties were so good. And the thing is, I was like, okay, but there's a way, because you've got Whimsy, right? Like, there's a way to break the Black Shield and Whimsy him and kill the Morgana. I was like, but they're using help picks to shield people. They actually can't break the Black Shield reasonably without Glitter Lancing, and then even that might not even be enough damage. And so he got perfect Morg ulties time and again in team fights. The follow-up, you try enough times and eventually do succeed. The TF ulti ganks that worked on the Nien, and that was crucial.
Yeah, I really, really liked that play for Man Cloud. And at Champion Select, I was like, okay, this works pretty well. But then I realized, oh, it's Twisted Fate against Lulu. You know, they'll go pretty even with each other. Mm-hmm. And then he just kept going after Nien over and over and over again. And I remember seeing St. Vicious go against with Chris up against Nien Tansu in the top lane. I was like, oh, gank the Shot Caller. That's a great idea.
Yeah.
Gank the Shot Caller, who's the linchpin of the team. That's an even better idea.
Yeah. Remove the win condition. And I mean, to be fair, Frankfin Gaming still did a freaking great job of pulling it back out. But hey, well played to both teams, and congrats to Curse Academy. So after today's matchup, let's see how the bracket shapes up. Curse Academy has, of course, clinched third place with the win today, meaning they earn another point in the standings and they automatically enter into Summer Series 2.
We will close the book on Summer Series 1 on Sunday, June 22nd, when Team Coast takes on Team LoLPro live at the Wembley Arena in London, England, before thousands of fans. That best of three match takes place before the EU LCS, so you won't want to miss that.
It's going to be fun. But before that, there's actually even more LCS and Challenger action you guys don't want to skip. Before the LCS begins tomorrow, we're back at it again to do it one more time for the EU Challenger Series as Gamers 2 takes on Loveland Shore to determine who takes third place in the EU Challenger Series.
Then on the NA LCS, it starts up when Dignitas takes on Complexity, then Team Solo Mid goes up against Evil Geniuses.
Then it's CounterLogic Gaming taking on Team Curse and Cloud9 versus LMQ. It all starts tomorrow at 9 a.m. Pacific Daylight Time, 6 p.m. Central European Summer Time. Now with that, we've reached the end of our time together tonight. I'll miss you guys, but before we go, I want to say thanks again to our friends at Coca-Cola. Now for myself, Zyrene, and the entire live broadcast crew, thanks for watching. Good night. GG.